These are the faces that line the halls of hockey history. Chiseled. Unflinching. Beneath their gaze burns a quiet rage. Without them, there would be no miracles on ice. No moments to last a lifetime. And no small-town boys who grew into legends.
Well, you know, when you're up north, that's all you have to do is to play hockey or sports, baseball, football, hockey, whatever it is.
Behind this working-class house in the northern Ontario hard rock mining town of Sudbury, the hockey roots run deep.
We started a little rink in the back of our yard. There was a creek, Nolan Creek. We built a rink there. And we put some, when the creek would freeze, we'd have a dig a hole in the ice and get the water pails and flood it by water with the water pails and all that. And the firemen got a hold of it. And the following year, they were doing it once a week for us. So we used to, that's how we started playing hockey in our own rink. And on weekends, we'd play the sons against the dads. And the dad used to just whomp us pretty good. And after a few years, we were whomping them pretty good. I think I had the dream when I started going to Sacred Heart College, which was a high school. I had a real good hockey team. And then before that, I was playing for Holy Trinity, and we had a great club. We didn't lose a game for something like 3 years. And a lot of the guys played in the NHL from that team. And I think that's when I got the bug to play in the National Hockey League was there. It's a little different today than it was in those days, but my wife's place. She lived on the wrong side of the tracks, I tell you that. I lived in the poor section. She says she lived in the poor section. So we're, you know, I keep telling her she belonged to Notre Dame, which was all the snobs. And we were St. Jean-Brébeuf, where all the toughies were. And, but, you know, we argue about that all the time. And she's quite a gal, let me tell you. I'm very fortunate.
When you broke in, there's only six teams in the NHL. Talk about, from a player's perspective, surviving, keeping a job, because your career was about that for a long time.
Well, I mean, when I started playing with the Red Wings, the manager, everybody was scared of each other. They were scared to get hurt, because in those days, you could have kept the four or five top players on the team and brought the whole Farms Club up. And never would have changed a bit. Nothing would have changed. So, you know, if somebody really got hurt, you didn't want to get hurt because you didn't want to tell anybody because you'd lose your job and you'd never get it back sometimes. I remember my partner was Red Kelly. He was an all-star defenseman. He had a broken foot. And we're in Montreal and we're walking down the street and Red says, I can't stand anymore. I got to sit down. I says, Red, and I looked at his foot. It was all swollen. I says, you got to go to the doctor here in Montreal. Let's go to the trainer. I know the guy pretty well. So we went over there. He sent to the doctor. And he put his foot in the cast. It was broken. He played on it for 2 weeks, a broken foot. And he was scared to lose his job, and he was an all-star.
What did that cup mean to you, the first one, the first time you had your name engraved?
Well, it's something that's really unbelievable. You know, when you think back, the upbringing I had in Sudbury, Ontario, and things like that, and dreaming about the cup and winning the cup, you just couldn't believe it. You kept pinching yourself every morning to find out, is this true? Am I really in here or what? Or, you know, am I part of this or what? It's really something that you can't really understand.
Al's long career path belied his abilities. He forged a lengthy NHL career when few could make it. Along the way, Al crossed paths with the greats of the game, including Gordie Howe.
Gordie Howe, maybe the greatest of all time. What was it like playing with a man like him?
You know,
to raise the cup. Enjoy cup-clinching games from the past three decades. Raising the Cup on NHL Network.
The addition of Goring was a big step forward, but Al knew he had to do more than change the roster. He had to look hard at himself make changes to his own style if the club was to continue its climb.
Hey, you know, you examine yourself and you examine all the players and you examine a lot of things, especially when you're losing like that. And I know that I used to go in the rink and he'd say, get rid of Al Arbour, don't trade anybody else, get rid of Arbour, get rid of Arbour. That's it. That's all he talked about, you know, in New York. And I changed, I analyzed everything, and we changed as a team. We changed a little bit here, a little bit there, all over the place. And I think it's a little experience we needed just to get over that hump. And we got over that hump against Philadelphia when we got that goal, because, you know, we were winning by a couple of goals and we got two goals, and it didn't look too promising then. And Bobby and I got that winning goal and got us over the hump, and after that we were nothing to it.
In a row. Talk about that run, because it's a dynasty.
Well, I mean, we had a great team. I mean, they could turn it on. You know, the Nystroms, the Howard, the Tonellis, the Lewis, they kept a lot of the guys. Lewis didn't play, he was in LA then, but they kept a lot of those guys till they got going. They kept Nystrom would chip a goal in, Tonelli would chip a goal in. Bossy with Trotsky, those guys did nothing. And all of a sudden they'd get going. We were on our way. That's what you needed.
And they apparently have. Here's Gretzky. Last word for Gretzky and Billy Smith. It's over. And the New York Islanders have won their fourth straight Stanley Cup. And in the middle of
you get over the hump finally in 1980. They have a run of 4 years. How much more difficult is it to play with a target on your back as opposed to what you had experienced in the late 70s?
That's much easier.
Really?
I think it's much easier. When you're winning like that, in the last year, we knew we were in trouble, because the fact that, you know, in those years, we won 4 years in a row, we were in the Stanley Cup Finals of the years. It's a long year, and we had two Canada Cups or something at that time. A lot of our players, the top players, were playing in the Canada Cup. They were worn right out. They didn't have enough time to recover. And we were lucky we got as far as we did the fifth year. I thought Montreal was going to beat us for sure. And we got by them. I can't believe this at all.
Though the Islanders' dynasty would give way to another in 1984, Al Arbour's legacy had long been cemented as a coach as well as a player.
Where'd your philosophy come from? Go back to when you began in St. Louis. Plager actually said, we're playing so horrible, and he chased one of the referees in Philadelphia off the ice, got hit in the head with a beer, and from that moment on, we became a team. Where did this coaching philosophy come from, Al?
Well, I always thought a team is a group of players, and you have to do whatever you have to do to get the team to their final goal. And some players, you have to act a certain way, some other players a different way. And I tried to maneuver the players around as much as I possibly could, but everything was meant for the team in the whole. And I did a lot of crazy things, but I thought it helped the team to a certain degree.
Yeah, just tell us a story about having the eggs in the pocket.
Oh, that's one of my players, a defenseman. I put the eggs in the pockets. I put an egg in all the places. And I told him, I says, well, you could go in the corner of those eggs and you come out of there, still they wouldn't be broken. Nobody'd hit you. You wouldn't hit anybody. There's no problem there.
Did the guys like this little trick?
Some of them did. Some of them didn't. I know Pat Price, he just I broke the eggs on my head. Yeah, he did.
Did he live to talk about it?
Barely.
85, 86, she retired for the first time.
Mm-hmm.
How come?
I was fed up. I was worn out physically, mentally, mostly mentally. And I thought I needed a rest, and I didn't think I'd go back to it. And I think I came back because of Bill Torrey. He says, I think we need you as a coach. He says, can you finish the year out for us? I said, well, you better start looking for a coach right now, because I'll finish the year out and that's it. So the year finished out, and I said, okay, well, who's your coach? He says, I didn't look for one yet. I said, well, thanks a lot. That's Bill Torrey for you.
You knew I'd have him in the NHL.
Did you know you were done for good, or did you think you were done for good?
I thought I was done for good, yeah. I was worn out.
2 years after retiring, Al Arbour returned to coach an additional six seasons with the Islanders. In a huge upset in the 1993 playoffs, the Islanders defeated the two-time defending Stanley Cup champion Pittsburgh Penguins, who were led by Al's former mentor, Scotty Bowman.
It was very special. I think that reached one right on top there with the Stanley Cup, because we didn't have much of a team compared to Pittsburgh. But I think that Gasparitis and Pilon and Glenn Healy in goal. Glenn Healy made a number of saves, and I think Casper and Pilon scared some of the top players, and I think that's why we won the game. I mean, it's not because, I mean, we had a Mullen, Mullen, I guess, one of the Mullens, watching Yager, imagine that, and Loisel watching Tockett. I said, oh my God, this is going to be, we used to shift them around all the time, changing on the fly. It means an awful lot to our team, to me especially, because I thought Pittsburgh had a great hockey team. They won the Stanley Cup the year before. They should have won it that year, but we managed to get in their way. And we were lucky, too, let's face it.
The old Boston Garden was a hockey cathedral, and the old barn on college.
Then coaching the Islanders, noticed an odd statistic. He saw that Al Arbour had coached 1,499 games with the team. Ted made a suggestion to Islanders owner Charles Wang.
Well, I thought somebody was pulling my leg. I said, I don't get this. He said, why do I get this? I remember I got a call from the owner of the Islanders, Charles Wang. He says, do you realize how many games you coached the Islanders? I says, no, I don't have a clue. I don't carry that around with me. He says, $14.99. He says, we got to coach one more game, so you're $1,500 with the Islanders. So I says, oh, I don't know about that. So I called Ted Nolan. He was coaching the team then. He was the Sault Ste. Marie at the reservation. I called him, and I said, look at Ted. I says, you know, I said, I got a call from the owner. He wants me to coach this one game. I says, look, I don't care if the game's in November or May. It's a big game. 2 points is 2 points. You don't have that good of a team. It's going to be close to get in the playoff. I don't want to cause any problems for you. He says, Al, you're not causing any problem for me. It's because I think I'm the one that thought about it, and I brought it up. I said, well, if you want me to coach that game, I will, but I need a lot of help. I don't know one guy from another on that team. He says, don't worry about it. Just we'll take care of it. So
were you nervous?
I wasn't nervous. I didn't know the players. That's the problem. I didn't know the players at all. And, you know, the game has changed an awful lot. I mean, now it's all skating, it's circling, and the systems they have now. I was in the coach's room, and they said, you want to see a play? You just push a button, and the play comes up. You push another button, there's another play. Oh, my God. I couldn't coach today on all that stuff. Unbelievable. I'll never forget the general manager came over to me the next morning. He says, Al, you did a hell of a job last time, but today we got to fire you. Oh, God, I laughed about that. And they gave me the papers at home, the pictures and all this, the starting lineup for both teams. And I was very happy that we got Pittsburgh, because Pittsburgh had one of the better teams in the league at that time. And they got ahead 2-0. I figured, oh, my God, it's going to be 10-0 my first game back. But we managed to come back and win.
Al Arbour finally coached his 1,500th game as an Islander. This night also earned him his 740th regular season win for the franchise that he helped turn into a dynasty. For Al, it was the crowning achievement in a glorious career. 8 Stanley Cups, 4 as a player and 4 as a coach, earned Al Arbour a place amongst the greats of the game.
Well, I think of all the awards I've won, I think the Hall of Fame is probably the greatest one of all. When you think yourself belong in the Hall of Fame is, you know, you did something special. I don't think I did anything special. I did what I had to do. But being a member of the Hall of Fame, you got to take pride in it. I mean, I don't care what it is. You think back and you see all the people that were responsible for my being there, from San Antonio all the way down to Denver, to Detroit, Chicago, Toronto. all the way. I mean, a lot of people involved in all this, and I think the being on the Hall of Fame means something very, very special to each and every one of us.